How much pressure underwater can the average person endure? You've seen my videos in this 5-meter swimming pool, and you've probably thought, well, this guy's got a good breath hold, but how does he deal with the pressure? So first things in mind, I'm not the average person. I'm of course a trained freediver, so I'm used to this. So today we're gonna give an answer to the question, how much pressure underwater can the average person, like you probably, endure? What is up, guys? My name is Gert Leroy. I'm a freediving instructor, a former national record holder, and a freediving YouTuber. So let's dive into this straight away. So pressure, what is pressure, right? So as you dive deeper, there is more pressure from the water. So when you're at the surface, we experience one bar or one atmosphere. This is the pressure that the air exerts on us. So our bodies, we are used to this because this is what we're feeling every single day. One bar, one atmosphere. If you dive deeper, there is more pressure from the water. When you dive to 20 meters, there is 3 bar. And when you dive to 30 meters, there is 4 bar. So at 10 meters, we already have double the pressure. Now, before I get any deeper into this, let me explain you the Boyle's law. In freediving, underwater diving, Boyle's law is very important. When you go deeper and there is more pressure, let's say double the pressure, 2 bar, then the volume of that air will get reduced with the same ratio, which is also 50%. So when you go to 10 meters, you have 2 bar, which means the air that is in your lungs will get compressed with 50%. So at 10 meters, your lungs are half the size. Then when you go deeper to 20 meters, we have 3 bar, which means your lungs are 33%. And at 30 meters, we have 4 bar. The lungs are now only 25% of its natural normal volume. Now I'm talking here about the air in your lungs, but besides the air in your lungs, there are other air spaces that get affected by the pressure as you dive deeper. And that is, for instance, your middle ear. So there is air inside of your ear, and that's why you have to equalize your ears. In maybe more slang language, you have to pop your ears. Equalization of the ears is very important because as you dive deeper, there is also pressure being exerted on the air spaces inside of your ear. And if you do not equalize your ears, and eventually the pressure of that water will rupture your eardrum. That's a serious condition. Besides your inner ears and your lungs, you also have the airspace inside of your sinuses and the airspace that is in between your face and your mask. That's why you also have to equalize your mask, because if you don't, then the mask will get sucked upon your face as you dive deeper, and eventually you will hurt your face, and even your eyeballs can get sucked out of their sockets because the mask is sucking your eyeballs out. Do you still want to free dive? I know, it's a dangerous sport if you don't know what you're doing. If you are aware of the possible dangers of diving deeper, then you can also prepare yourself better for it, right? Now, what else can happen? In professional freediving, and this will not happen in recreational freediving, but when you really start to dive deeper, what can happen is a lung squeeze. In freediving, we call lung squeeze or lung barotrauma. This happens when the alveoli, which are the little air sacs that are responsible for the gas exchange, oxygen uptake, and CO2 carbon dioxide release, when they get ruptured. So basically they start bleeding. So when you have a lung squeeze and you come up from a dive and you have to cough a little bit, it might be that there is blood coming out. Another possible issue is a trachea squeeze. Trachea is the air pipe that is in here. So besides hurting your lungs, you can also hurt your trachea. And this usually happens when there is too much head movement involved. When you dive deeper, you cannot look down, because if you look down, imagine me being turned upside down, and you look down, then you are stretching. You're stretching your throat. You're stretching this area here, and you're stretching the trachea. And when all of this is under so much pressure, because you're diving really deep, then you can really hurt your trachea. So you have to keep your head in a neutral position, chin tucked down a little bit to avoid a trachea squeeze. You can also experience nitrogen narcosis. Yes, that is right. You can feel a little bit dizzy, narked, like we say in freediving, when you're diving deep. Again, this is professional freediving. When you dive to 10, 20, 30, 40 meters, this will never happen. But professional freediving, competitive freediving, when you reach depths of, let's say, 80, 90, 100 meters, yes, very deep, then it can be that you feel this narcosis. And when you feel narcosis, it is very difficult to keep your mind at the diving and to really have full control over what you're doing. So that might possibly be a dangerous situation. And you may ask yourself now, what about decompression sickness? Because in scuba diving, decompression sickness is a real issue. That's why they have these deco stops, right? You can't just go all the way up at once. You have to stop at certain intervals to give your body the time to deal with the gases and the nitrogen that has accumulated in your body. So what about freediving? Well, the good news is you don't have deco stops. So you don't have decompression stops. In freediving, you can go up again in one time, pretty fast actually, without a problem. Now, does that mean that decompression sickness never happens in freediving? No. Once again, I know it's a complicated sport. In very deep freediving, professional freediving, it can happen under certain circumstances that decompression sickness indeed happens, and there have been some cases reported. But this is really an exception, and the general rule in freediving is don't worry about decompression sickness, it will not happen. So now that we understand better about the possible dangers of diving deeper, what can we do about it, right? So I know you want to get an answer to the question, how much pressure can the average person like you endure? We'll come to that, so stick with me, we're almost there. What can we do to mitigate the possible risks of diving deeper? First of all, relaxation. Relaxation is key. What is the opposite of relaxation? It is stress. So when you're all stressed, when you're all tense, your body cannot give in to the pressure of the water. The more flexible you are, the more you stretch, the more flexible you are in your thoracic area, the better your body can accept the pressure. If this is all rigid and tense, then the pressure of the water is fighting against your ribcage. But if this is flexible, then your ribcage can be bent inwards and it's easier to deal with that pressure. So relaxation and flexibility, they all come together. The more you are relaxed in your mind, the more you will be relaxed and flexible in your body. If you're wondering on what kind of stretching exercises you can do for freediving, then watch this video here. I'll also link it up in the description. What else can we do? You can learn to properly equalize. Now, many people don't understand that when their equalization technique is wrong, in other words, when they equalize too forcefully, you can actually hurt your lungs. And maybe you've already experienced this when you try to equalize and it didn't really go well and you were trying to push even harder, that eventually maybe some blood came out of your lungs because you're rupturing the alveoli by putting so much pressure on it. So when you learn to equalize gently with minimal effort, then you won't hurt your lungs. I have a whole playlist of videos teaching you on how to equalize. So if you're interested in that, I'll link it up in the cards here and in the description as well. Now, practice makes perfect. So if you practice all these techniques more, you'll get better at it. And as you hold your breath more and you spend more time in the water on breath holds, something magical will happen, besides you mastering the skills, and that is the development of the mammalian diving reflex. That is right, the MDR. The mammalian diving reflex is a reflex that is highly developed in aquatic mammals like dolphins, like whales, like turtles, or even beavers. So these animals can hold their breath long underwater. Why is that? Because of the highly developed MDR. The good news is, we humans, we have an MDR, mammalian diving reflex, as well, but we have to develop it. Now, the MDR consists of four physiological adaptations that help us protect from injuries caused by diving deeper. That sounds absolutely fantastic, right? So number one is bradycardia. So when you hold your breath, your body goes into some kind of survival mechanism and bradycardia kicks in. So 10 to 25% lower heartbeat is very normal when you hold your breath. So when your heartbeat goes lower, you automatically go into a state of more relaxation. And when you're more relaxed, you will be less tense, so you can deal better with the pressure of the water. You got it? Physiological adaptation number two of the MDR is peripheral vasoconstriction. Peripheral means to the extremities of the body, like the fingers and the toes. And vasoconstriction means that the blood vessels become more narrow, which means that there is less blood flow to the extremities of the body and more blood flow to the vital organs like the brain, the heart, and the lungs. So when there is more blood flow to the vital organs, it's again that survival mechanism that kicks in to keep you alive. Not saying you're gonna die, of course, but this is what your body is thinking of. When you hold your breath and you dive deeper, automatically you will get more blood flow to the vital organs. Third physiological adaptation is the bloodshift besides the vasoconstriction, and the bloodshift is basically even more blood that gets pumped towards your lungs to protect them. Once you reach depths of around 30-40 meters and you reach residual volume, which is the volume where your lungs cannot get compressed anymore, once you reach that depth, bloodshift happens. And you could compare this with a cushion of blood. The blood surrounds your lungs and kind of protects them from getting crushed by the pressure of the water. So if you ever wonder how it is possible that advanced freedivers dive over 100 meters, well, it is because mainly of that blood shift protecting the lungs. And then fourth, but not least, the spleen contraction. So the spleen is a fist-sized organ at the upper left side of your abdomen, next to your stomach and behind your left ribs. So the spleen contracts when we hold our breath and ejects blood cells that are rich with oxygen. So when the spleen contraction happens, red blood cells that are high in oxygen get ejected into our bloodstream so we can hold our breath longer. All of these four adaptations that are part of the MDR help us survive better underwater. So let's take a look at freediving records. So we're not talking about average people here now, right? We're talking about highly trained professional freedivers. Let's start with the beginning. Somewhere around 1950, scientists said that it was impossible to dive deeper than 30-40 meters because your lungs will get imploded and you would simply die. Now, there was a guy called Enzo Mallorca, who was the first man to dive to 50 meters, who proved science wrong. Later on, Jacques Mayol, who was the first one to dive to 100 meters, well, made a bigger statement, right? So it is around 1950, more or less, that we got to know about the blood shift and about the MDR protecting the lungs. If you want to know more about Enzo Mallorca and Jacques Mayol, then you should definitely watch the freediving cult movie, The Big Blue, Le Grand Bleu, directed by Luc Besson from 1988. This is a movie older than 30 years. But if you are a freediver or if you are interested in holding your breath, being underwater, then you should absolutely watch that movie. Okay, more recently now, 2007, Herbert Nietzsche for the discipline No Limits. No Limits is an extreme way of freediving. We don't really do that much anymore because No Limits is an assisted way of freediving. Assisted because you're using a weighted sledge. So you're holding on to that sledge and you get catapulted to the depths of the ocean. And Herbert Nietzsche in 2007, he went down to 214 meters or 702 feet, which is 22 bar. That is 22 times the normal pressure on your body. Can you imagine that? And a couple of years later in 2012, he went to 253 meters or 831 feet, which is 26 bar, but an accident happened there. He suffered serious decompression sickness. He needed months of rehabilitation and several brain strokes before he actually got better. Okay, so that is all part of freediving history. Let's talk about current, modern, right now freediving, right? So what is the current world record in the discipline constant weight with a monofin, because that is where people go the deepest? This is 236 meters or 464 feet by Alexei Moshanov, the son of Natalia Moshanova, who is considered as the queen of freediving and who sadly passed away in a tragic incident many years ago. And for the females, that is Alessia Zaccini with 123 meters or 404 feet, which is 13 bar. Guys, thank you for sticking with me until here. Now I'm going to answer your question. How much pressure can the average person endure on breath hold underwater? So a beginner's freediving course goes to 12 to 20 meters. That is 40 feet to 65 feet. Depending on the organization where you follow a freediving course, and you can do that in only 2 or 3 days. Now, if you look at my videos in that 5 meter swimming pool, 5 meters deep is only 1.5 bar more than the normal pressure. Anyone, the average person, can withstand, can endure 1.5 bar and go down to 5 meters deep. What stops people from diving down to 5 meters deep is fear. It is the idea that they cannot do this and they will die and something will happen. Guys, if you want to learn the basics of freediving, then click this video here. I'll link it up in the description. Peace in every breath.